First of all, I'm kind of nervous to stand in boundaries because I don't like boundaries. I like to break them. So since I come from the entertainment business, this is, which is the E in TED, I want you all to clap so that I'll get a little comfortable. Thank you. More. Yeah. I don't know if I deserve to be here yet, but my journey is a very simple one, and I wondered why they called me over here, and the answer was maybe because of the day, that juncture in your life where your dream came true, and I am here to talk about just that very short journey of mine where my dreams came true. So to start off with, I belong to a very middle class family. I belonged to a middle class family from Vizag. And we all, the whole family used to gather for festivals and we used to celebrate together. And we used to watch this so-called Sankranti releases together. I think that's where I picked up this passion for films. I used to imitate all my 90s heroes. And I had a lot of influence of them on me. And in my schooling, I clearly remember the point where I watched this film called Sakhi. I don't know if you guys know it. I was in my fifth standard when it came out. It was directed by Mr. Mani Ratnam. And that film really changed the way for me to the way that I look at cinema. And I wanted to know what goes behind the camera, what is the process that is involved in filmmaking. And that really grabbed my attention. I didn't know I would become a director then. I didn't know if I would become an actor or something. But I was very curious about the process. And I fell into this regular trap of schooling, which is not too bad, of course. I had a lot of fun growing up. And then after my 10th standard, while I was doing my 10th standard, I was told by my lecturers, teachers, that, get this 10th standard right and your life is sorted. I thought it was real, and then I moved to intermediate. And trust me, that's the worst phase of my life. I wouldn't even want to get back to my intermediate days ever. Because first of all, there was uniform. Second of all, it was not a co-ed. Now, can you imagine spending 2 years of your life just looking at boys alone? That's scary, right? Yeah, it was scary indeed. But then a good thing happened. I got introduced to a friend of mine who is equally passionate about films. And that's where our conversation started, and it didn't even end till today while coming here. So I'm glad I found one guy who's just like me and who had the same passion of what I had. And again, the same thing repeated in intermediate as well. Just crack intermediate and your life is sorted, which didn't happen. Thank God I had all-in-ones because my percentages were good. And I used to buy heart every damn thing because I really didn't get in, something didn't get into my head, dude. What can I do? It's my manufacturing defect, maybe. So, and then intermediate, my MCET, which was the entrance exam to get into engineering. And engineering was supposed to be the coolest thing back then. All my friends were doing engineering. And I aimed for the sky. I was close, I guess. My rank was somewhere around, I remember, 119015. And that, yeah, that looked like an ex-showroom price of a nano car back then. So thanks to the PR my mom made, I got a management quota seat in an engineering college. It was supposed to be the best colleges in Vizag. And I picked chemical engineering, guys. Chemical engineering. I didn't know what that meant. I didn't know what I'm going to study. But I just went there to study because I don't know. I don't know if it's a taboo or something. But apart from engineering, nothing was considered as a degree back then. You know, if you're doing BA, that's not a degree. That's not a degree. Who said it's a degree? It's not. So I took up engineering, and once I entered engineering, my eyes opened wide because I couldn't buy out anything anymore. All the derivatives and the calculus that's involved. Then as like the most of you all, because that's why I feel very nostalgic coming here, because the atmosphere around me is very nostalgic. And I see not many students are here today because they thought TEDx was a very intellectual event. Because if I was in this college, I would have skipped this event. So, but then, yeah. So engineering, I had my first love ever. I went through a major heartbreak by the end of my first year. Yeah, it was a very amateurish kind of thing. But, you know, while growing up, 18, 19, which, you know, you feel that that girl is going to be there for your lifetime. And I changed my dreams. I all of a sudden wanted to do a job in the line of chemical engineering. I was too passionate about education. And once my heart was broken, I came down to my grounds and said, what the hell I was doing all this while? How could I forget my dream and something which I am passionate about? And that's where I learned my first lesson in life, not to give up your dreams for anyone else, not even for your parents, trust me. Because you are on your own in this world, and if you ditch yourself, nobody's going to help you. And then I picked up writing as a hobby. I started writing a few trail and error methods. I had this stupid ego that I wanted to be a self-taught because I didn't want to get influenced by anyone. So I was self-taught, and I few trail and error methods, couple of short films which I'm not very proud of, helped me gain some knowledge in filmmaking. And I remember in my third year of engineering, I was frustrated. I couldn't do that anymore. I had one backlog in every semester and it was piling up. So I decided to quit. I decided not to go ahead with engineering anymore. And I told my dad, he didn't react to it. But my mom was very furious and she was like, how the hell can you do that? What would our neighbors think? What would our family think if you quit engineering? And she thought quitting engineering was a failure and I would become a failure in life if I quit engineering. But it was not the truth. And after that, we struck a deal together saying, you finish engineering in first class, that's 60%, because you wouldn't be eligible for campus interviews back then. I don't know how's the case now. But finish your engineering first class and I would give you 2 years after engineering for you to pursue your dreams. Maybe they thought in these 2 years, things might change and I might get a job and I might settle down in the routine circle of life. But I was very serious. I took that deal very serious and I did my best because I asked all my classmates to, you know, I used to call them home for combined studies and I don't like reading. I like listening. So they used to tell the whole, we have 5 units, right? Out of which if you write 3 or 4 units, you are good enough to pass. That's correct. Yeah, so they used to tell the whole unit as a story to me. So it had a beginning, it had a middle, it had an ending. So in between whatever is that, it's my own creativity that came up in the examination hall. So I just know the beginning, middle and the end of every unit. So I could write and I could pass through my exams. I still remember April 24th was the date in 2012. Where I wrote my final exam of the final semester of the final year. And trust me, that feeling when I gave my answer sheet to the invigilator and I ran out of the hall. I ran straight to my department and I told my professors. My professors were friendly. They used to give me attendance and all for the kind of creative work that I used to do for college. And I told them, see, listen, my percentage is around 57.5. And I came to know that you guys are correcting my answer sheets. So please make sure I get 60%. This is a life or death question. So, and I told them, I ran out of the college. I took my bullet. I started driving back home. I'm not even exaggerating, guys. I started to scream in joy. I started to cry like a kid. I didn't know why, because I finally, that fight was over. The fight I was fighting for 4 years, it was over. But little did I realize that I had a bigger fight to, you know, bigger battle to fight, where I'm on the one side and the other, the whole of the world is on the other side, trying to get a chance to point out at me, to judge me and the profession I'm going to choose. 2 days after my final exam, I left to Hyderabad. I moved to Hyderabad. It was a painful process for me to go through because Vizag was a dear city and it will be always. It was hard for me to leave the city and the friends. I moved to Hyderabad and my parents had a tough time adjusting to the fact that I'm doing something which nobody knows of in my family because I had no film background. I know nobody from films. I was set out on this journey alone and After moving to Hyderabad, about 20 to 25 days later, I was calling everyone. I was going to film offices to see if I can get a chance to work as an assistant director and learn the realities of filmmaking, the practicals of filmmaking. Because entertainment looks like an easy job, but it's really not. It's very tough to make a film. It's hard. It's very hard. You won't even believe. So I got a chance in one film as an assistant director. I went there in the morning, I said hello, and I felt so out of place. I didn't know, because there were people aged from 35 to 40 around me, and I was just 21 back then. So something didn't connect. The wavelength or the frequency didn't match with the people I was working with. And I come from a very different film approach. I believe in the... As the remodeling insight says, I wanted to showcase something new, because all my life when I watched films, when I didn't like it, I used to rip them apart. I used to insult the films by walking out of the theater. And I come from that approach in my head. And these guys were practicing dance numbers in front of me, and which really threw me off, because I was against dances in the film, because who would dance in real life, right? You wouldn't dance with your girlfriend right after she accepted your proposal, right? Yeah, exactly. So 4 hours, it felt like ages. And then I told the director, sir, I'm not feeling well. I have some stomach upset or something. I'll come tomorrow. And he gave a big stare at me, like, you know, you're not coming tomorrow. I know that. He gave me that stare. And I went home and I called up the one who referred me there, and I told Macha, this is not happening with me, so I can't work for the cinema. So my first job ever, that was for 4 hours. Yeah, and a week later, I started building my connections through Facebook, thanks to the internet. When I was in my college, I got in touch with a couple of film people who I thought were doing interesting work back then. And one of them was Advisesh, the writer and director, actor and writer. So he was making a film, he was directing a film, and I went, spoke to him. I thought somewhere the frequency was matching. And I worked as an assistant director for his film in 2012. Yeah, 2012, and the film released in 2013. Everyone put a lot of hard work into it, and everyone took the film so personally. And we were too much in love that we neglected all the mistakes the film had, and that film tanked. People were laughing at us. Even I was an assistant director, I took that film very personally, and we were heartbroken. We didn't know what to do. We were clueless when that film tanked. And that was a scary experience. I never want to experience that kind of failure in my life. And then 3 months later, that film released in early 2014, I guess. Sesh called me up and said, hey, I want you to direct one film. I was like, what? The film I worked for tanked big time, and now he wants me to do my debut as a director. I said, okay. I didn't know if it was too early or too late, but I know all I knew was it was an opportunity and I shouldn't leave it. So I went ahead, and he told me the plot of Kshanam way before, and I was more than happy to do that plot, and we started writing together, and that process really helped me, because we told ourselves, never love your work, never do that, because if you start loving your work, you would neglect all the flaws in it. Be a bitch. I'm sorry, bitch is not a negative word, but be your be the villain of your work. You know, always try to criticize yourself. Always try to stay to the grounds and see what's going wrong. Because you, as people with common instincts, with basic instincts, we have a feeling, right? If it's right or not. So we have to just make sure and be grounded so that we realize when something is going wrong. Because I went into I didn't want people to walk out of my theater for my first film when I was doing it. And the plot was very new. We didn't watch films like that till then. We all had this song numbers and dance numbers and all the masala films back then. It was getting too cliche, too routine, and people... See, I am getting bored by the films that I'm watching. I'm an audience first, more than a filmmaker. I only want to make films that I want to watch myself in the theater. And this rule applies to every profession, not just films. If you want to do something new, I remember when I was in school, everybody had hairline partitions on this side. And I used to observe everyone in the assembly standing around. Everybody had the hairline partitions this side. And I started my hairline partition this side. I started combing my hair this side. I didn't know if I was trying too hard, but I wanted to be different from everyone. I wanted to be the special one in the class where you get a lot of attention. I was an attention seeker. I still am an attention seeker. That's why I'm here to speak in front of you. There's a lot of attention towards me, which excites me as someone from the entertainment business. So that happened, and it's been the same all my life. I wanted to be different from everyone. And then Kshanam, it took almost 2 years. It's like mini Bahubali for us, making that film, because we were given a budget of 1 crore. 1 crore seems like a lot, but in film language, 1 crore is very less. You can't do anything about it. So we made that film. It released on 26th. I was so nervous that I had to pass out the night before. I couldn't sleep, and that film released, and that moment when I, you know, all my dreams came true. I was overwhelmed. My family was nervous, my girlfriend, my parents, my friends, everybody was nervous. And thankfully, the film did well, and it was not just critically acclaimed, but it was also commercially, it did good numbers at the box office at the time where masala films are doing a lot. And since then, life has never been the same. And if you want to break the stereotypes in your life, what I would suggest is that be detached from yourself, because only from a third point perspective, you'll know where you're going wrong. And only the detachment is the key. So detach yourself from the process, go back, revisit the entire process 3-4 times at least, so that you're sure that you're not going wrong. And that is the only key that helped me, you know, stand in front of you here. And a week later of the release, this is a week later of the release, you know, the obvious question creeped up in everyone's heads: what next? And I was like, yeah, this film just released 1 week ago. Give me some time. Don't put so much pressure on me. But that's how life is. You know, it doesn't matter how many times you succeed or fail in your life. What matters the most is the spirit with which you carry till the end. So yeah, the spirit that you carry till the end, which matters the most. So be positive. Lots of positive energy would help you breaking any kind of stereotype and remolding any kind of insight. So thank you.